find salvation in him. I trust in him. I trust the Lord is my light and salvation in him. I trust. My light and salvation in him. I trust in him. I trust the Lord is my light and salvation in him. I trust. I trust the Lord is my light and salvation in him. I trust in him. I trust the Lord is my light. My light and salvation in him. I trust in him. I trust the Lord is my light and salvation in him. I trust in him. I trust.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you. Dear brothers and sisters, 40 days have passed since we celebrated the joyful feast of the Nativity of the Lord. Today is the blessed day when Jesus was presented in the temple by Mary. Outwardly, he was fulfilling the law, but in reality, he was coming to meet his believing people. Prompted by the Holy Spirit, Simeon and Anna came to the temple. Enlightened by the same Spirit, they recognized the Lord and confessed him with exultation. So let us also, gathered together by the Holy Spirit, proceed to the house of God to encounter Christ. There we shall find him and recognize him in the breaking of the bread until he comes again, revealed in glory. Let us pray. O God, source and origin of all light, who on this day showed to the just man Simeon the light for revelation to the Gentiles, we humbly ask that, in answer to your people's prayers, you may be pleased to sanctify with your blessing these candles, which we are eager to carry in praise of your name, so that treading the path of virtue, we may reach that light which never fails, through Christ our Lord. Amen. That surprised you. Let us go in peace to meet in the name of Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, we humbly implore your majesty that just as your only begotten Son was presented on this day in the temple, in the substance of our flesh, so by your grace we may be presented to you with minds made pure. To our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the prophet Malachi. The Lord God says this: Look, I am going to send my messengers to prepare a way before me, and the Lord you are seeking will suddenly enter his temple. And the angel of the covenant, whom you are longing for, yes, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. Who will be able to resist the day of his coming? Who will remain standing when he appears? For he is like the refiner's fire and the fuller's alkali. He will take his seat as a refiner and purifier. He will purify and make the offering to the Lord as it should be made. The offering of Judah and Jerusalem will then be welcomed by the Lord, as in former days, as in the years of old. The word of the Lord.
Reveal to them your word.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Since all the children share the same blood and flesh, Jesus too shared equally in it, so that by his death he could take away all the power of the devil, who had power over death, and set free all those who had been held in slavery all their lives by the fear of death. For it was not the angels that he took to himself. He took to himself descent from Abraham. It was essential that he should, in this way, become completely like his brothers, so that he could be a compassionate and trustworthy high priest of God's religion, able to atone for human sins. That is, because he has himself been through temptation, he is able to help others who are tempted. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. When the day came for them to be purified as laid down by the law of Moses, the parents of Jesus took him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. Observing what stands written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male must be consecrated to the Lord, and also to offer in sacrifice in accordance with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now in Jerusalem, there was a man named Simeon. He was an upright and devout man. He looked forward to Israel's comforting, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death until he had set eyes on the Christ of the Lord. Prompted by the Spirit, he came to the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the law required, he took him into his arms and blessed God. And he said, "Now, Master, you can let your servant go in peace, just as you promised, because my eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared for all the nations to see. A light to enlighten the pagans and the glory of your people Israel." As the child's father and mother stood there, wondering at what things that were being said about him, Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, "You see this child, he is destined for the fall and for the rising of many in Israel, destined to be a sign that is rejected, and a sword will pierce your own soul too, so that the secret thoughts of many may be laid bare. There was a prophetess also, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was well on in years, her days of childhood over. She had been married for 7 years before becoming a widow. She was now 84 years old and never left the temple, serving God night and day with fasting and prayer. She came by just at that moment and began to praise God, and she spoke of the child to all who looked forward to the deliverance of Jerusalem. When they had done everything the Lord of the Lord required, they went back to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. Meanwhile, the child grew in maturity, and he was filled with wisdom, and God's favor was with him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Dear sisters and brothers in religious and consecrated life, dear friends in the Lord Jesus who is the light in our world and our hearts, which nothing can extinguish, not even cold holy water. Coming 40 days, yes, it really is 40 days, after the celebration of our Lord's birth at Christmas, today's feast of his presentation in the temple is, in one sense, a continuation of the Epiphany. The arrival of the Magi from the east signaled the showing, the appearance, the manifestation of Christ as the saving light to the nations. In fact, the saving light to the whole world. In a new way, at his presentation, this manifestation happens again. When faithful to the Jewish law, Mary and Joseph complete the rituals following childbirth. Their offering is not a lamb, the offering of the wealthy, but the offering prescribed for the poor. Two doves, two pigeons, worth next to nothing. Of course, the true lamb is their child, the Lamb of God, who makes us rich by taking away our sins. It is there in the temple that the Lord Jesus is revealed to Anna and to Simeon. They were devout believers. They waited and watched for all their lives for the Messiah to be revealed. They yearned and they longed for salvation to be personified, to be incarnate, and to appear in their day. And this is exactly what happens before their expectant eyes and their expectant hearts. While St. Luke describes Anna, as we know, as well on in years, no age is given for Simeon, although most scholars believe he too was advanced in years. Isn't it always good to be reminded that just as God can use our youth and our middle age, He can also use our older years. In the kingdom, no one is on the scrap heap. No one. We remain youthful by the renewal of the Holy Spirit. Anna and Simeon were faithful. They were faithful witnesses who had experienced an encounter with their Saviour. In the Byzantine Christian tradition, this feast is called the meeting of our Lord and God and Saviour Jesus Christ. Well, in this meeting in the temple, Anna and Simeon represent the whole of Israel. In this meeting in the temple, Anna and Simeon anticipate the church. In this meeting in the temple, Anna and Simeon prepare the way for you and me. And yet, even though the Lord Jesus is but a babe in the arms, this encounter, this meeting, is bittersweet. Jesus is the long recognized and expected Messiah. But the Catechism tells us He is light to the nations, the glory of Israel, but a sign that is to be spoken against. The sword of sorrow, predicted for Mary, announces our Lord's unique offering on the cross that will impart salvation, the salvation God has prepared in the presence of His peoples. This meeting in the temple is bitter sweet. With the shepherds and the magi, Anna and Simeon join the company of the first disciples of Christ. How beautifully, how humbly they reflect the attitude of a believer, of a disciple. Just picture it for a moment in your imagination. Imagine the temple. See Our Lady and St. Joseph. See the child Jesus. And picture Anna and Simeon. What do they look like? As we picture this encounter with the Holy Family and these first disciples of the Lord Jesus, their dispositions, their responses, they speak to us. So what are Anna and Simeon teaching the church? What are Anna and Simeon teaching us? Here's four things. The Holy Spirit rested on Simeon, who was upright and devout, who looked for the comforting arrival of God's anointed one. There is a lesson here for us, to live under the Holy Spirit, uprightly, devoutly, with expectant hearts. The prophetess Anna, at 84 years old, was always in the temple, night and day, serving, praising, fasting, praying. She's teaching us how to live the Christian life. Simeon embraced the Christ child, physically holding him in his arms. He blessed God. He blessed Mary and he blessed Joseph. And his words are so resonant with gratitude for peace, for fulfillment, for salvation, for light, for glory, all of which comes through the Lord Jesus entering our world. Simeon is teaching us what it means to embrace Christ. Anna spoke of the Lord Jesus, as I imagine it, to anyone and everyone. I like to think that you couldn't get away from her without hearing about the Lord Jesus. She spoke to everyone, especially, who hoped for forgiveness, for healing, for freedom, because she knew Jesus was and is the answer to our deepest searching. Anna teaches us to be evangelists. We all need to learn from Anna and Simeon. And you, dear sisters and brothers in religious and consecrated life, are, I think, in a special way, Anna's and Simeon's for the church and the world today. We need you, like them, to embody the desire that God's promises be fulfilled, here and now, in conversion and faith, in justice and in peace, and in heaven, completely and forever. We need you to stand tall as sentinels, watchmen, watchwomen, sentinels of the kingdom, who live joyfully within the gift of what God has already given, but who are ever hopeful for what is still to come. We need you to capture and exemplify the sheer delight of personal encounter with Christ, to showcase individually and communally an essential fidelity to God's word, and an intimate, adoring union with the Eucharistic Jesus. We need you to signpost an indispensable trust in God's power and presence and purpose, to be in simplicity and splendor women and men of deep and enduring faith. Our world, our church, our archdiocese, its clergy, its laity, not least its archbishop, need you to point prophetically to the temple where Christ is to be encountered today. For all that you do, in so many different ways, across our archdiocese, I extend to each of you a sincere thank you. To those of you celebrating significant jubilees of profession in this year, many, many heartfelt congratulations and every blessing. If you think this homily is coming to land, it's about to take off again, so brace yourselves. Sometimes, we need imagery to help us consider our discipleship and witness. And we find it powerfully throughout the scriptures of the Mass today. But it is to the first reading from the prophet Malachi that I want to turn. Anna and Simeon would have known their scriptures. So I wonder if, when they encountered the Lord Jesus at his presentation, I wonder if they remembered Malachi's words. The Lord you are seeking will enter his temple, for he is like the refiner's fire, and the fuller's alkali. For a long time, I never knew what those words meant. What on earth is the refiner's fire? What on earth is the fuller's alkali? Perhaps these allusions were clearer to Annie and Simeon than they are to us. So just in case anybody else has my lack of ignorance, let's be clear. The refiner, which Malachi talks about, is a purifier of silver. It's mentioned explicitly in the Hebrew text, but not in our translation. The silver refiner's job was to heat lead ore to red-hot temperatures in order to extract the silver. The process caused the impurities to rise to the surface, and the top of the molten metal could be scraped off, leaving behind it pure and precious silver. What about a fuller? A fuller worked in a kind of laundry, and he or she used the ashes from a burned plant to make an alkali soap, and it was used to clean and whiten cloth. The Hebrew word for fuller means to tread, to stamp on. The fuller would soak cloth in water and soap and then take it out and stamp on it or beat it to get rid of the dirt and the impurities. So if you didn't know before, you know now. What the refiner's fire is about and what the fuller's alkali is about. Now, in these images, there is a very down-to-earth, nitty-gritty truth which I think is valid for all discipleship and, I imagine, certainly for religious and consecrated life. So let's just hear the prophet Malachi again. The Lord you are seeking will enter his temple, for he is like the refiner's fire. That is, he's like a heat that purifies, but can sometimes metaphorically feel too hot to handle, too hot to touch. And he, the Lord, in his temple, is like the fuller's alkali, like a cleansing bath, which again, metaphorically, can sometimes feel like being trodden on or being beaten. I wonder if any of this is familiar to your vocational journey, that sometimes meeting the Lord is just a bit too hot to handle, and that sometimes the opposite of being raised up is that we sometimes feel like we're being trampled down. Dear friends, our life in Christ together is a life of conversion. St. Thomas Aquinas describes sin as aversio a Deo, a turning away, an aversion from God. But we seek the very opposite. Our whole lives are a turning towards God, a conversio, a conversion in and through Christ. Isn't your life as religious and consecrated people, isn't your life at heart, inevitably and rightly, a yearning for conversion, for holiness, for a heart turned fully to God? And especially when lived in community, in poverty, under obedience, and through chastity, isn't it sometimes the case that the heat is turned up and the ego trampled? This only makes sense. This living in the crucible of conversion as a purification, this dying to self, this jubilant encounter with Christ only makes sense if He is our first love and our true love. After his presentation, Mary and Joseph took the child Jesus back home to Nazareth, where he matured humanly and was filled with wisdom and God's favor. Whatever our charism, whatever our ministry, we need a heart for Nazareth, for a hidden growth in holiness through ordinariness. For disciples, the work of purification is Christ's. It's Christ who takes away from us our impurities. For disciples, the work of cleansing is Christ's. It's Christ who washes and renews. It's the work of his love, because he is our trustworthy and compassionate high priest, able to atone for our sins. Our freedom in Christ takes root only by means of love, even when it's hot to handle and it can feel like we're trampled underfoot. Freedom in Christ only takes root through love, even when it demands sacrifice. Our holiness is either about love, our lives are either about love, or they're about nothing. Today then, individually and together, we ask the questions on the lips of the psalmist. In the temple, who is the King of glory? In the temple of purification and refinement and cleansing, who is the King of love? And with expectant, joyful hearts, we reply with one voice, "It is the Lord." So let him enter. Let him enter the temple of my heart as the King of glory and the King of love. Please stand as we pray together. Let us now bring before God our Father the prayers and intentions of our hearts for the world and the church, for our lives and for our faith, for our fears and our hopes.
We pray for Pope Francis. Lord, we pray for Pope Francis as he serves the Church in these challenging times, and we thank you for the gifts you've given him, gifts of mercy and compassion, gifts of hearing the cry of the poor and the cry of the earth, the gifts of challenging and encouraging tirelessly all people of goodwill to take care of the vulnerable and to care for our common home. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for Archbishop John. Lord, we pray for Archbishop John that he may experience God's strength and wisdom
as he continues to lead and guide the Archdiocese. We pray also for the many needs of our Archdiocese. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for all consecrated people in our archdiocese. We pray for all consecrated people in our archdiocese. We thank you for the richness and diversity of our gifts and charisms, all offered and bestowed on us by your Holy Spirit for your honor and glory and the good of all. May we continue to care for others with humility and simplicity in the fields of education, health ministries, evangelization, and pastoral care, especially to the poorest, weakest, and those who suffer. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all those in consecrated life who have died in the past 2 years. Lord, we pray for all those in consecrated life who have died, especially those who have died in the past 2 years. We thank you for their years of faithful service to all your people and pray that they may now enjoy the peace and the fullness of eternal life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
The harvest is rich, but the laborers are few. We pray today, Lord, for an increase of vocations in Sadark, the consecrated life and the priesthood. And we pray particularly for those in formation for religious life and the priesthood. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For those who have asked us to pray for them, we pray today, Lord, for all those who have asked for our prayers. In particular, we pray for all those who have been affected by the coronavirus, especially their families and their friends. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for Pope Francis as he leads us in the Synod. We pray for Pope Francis as he leads the Church during this time of preparation for the Synod. May this time of discernment and renewal be blessed and guided by the Holy Spirit, so that together we become the face of Christ in the service of the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Our Blessed Lady is the patroness of our Archdiocese. We ask her intercession now as we say together, Hail, Holy Queen, Mother of mercy.
Hail our life, our sweetness, and our hope. To thee do we cry, O banished children of Eve. To thee do we send up our sighs, mourning and weeping in this vale of tears. Turn then, most gracious Advocate, thine eyes of mercy towards us. And after this, our exile, show unto us the blessed fruit of thy womb, Jesus. O Holy Mary, loving, O sweet Virgin Mary.
Heavenly Father, hear the prayers we present to you with faith in this temple. Help us to encounter your Son in our celebration and in our life. And hear the prayers we make with faith through Christ our Lord.
Come on.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the offering made with exultation by your church be pleasing to you, O Lord, we pray, for you willed that your only begotten Son be offered to you for the life of the world as the Lamb without blemish, who lives and reigns forever and ever. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For your co-equal Son was presented on this day in the temple and revealed by the Spirit as the glory of Israel and the light of the nations. And so we too go forth, rejoicing to encounter your salvation, and with the angels and saints praise you, as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
Of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance of your life, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth. With your servant Francis, our Pope, and John, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admission to your kingdom. There, we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
At the Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our day, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign for ever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer to each other the sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Stand on high.
Let us pray. By these holy gifts which we have received, O Lord, bring your grace to perfection within us. And as you fulfilled Simeon's expectation that he would not see death until he had been privileged to welcome the Christ, so may we, going forth to meet the Lord, obtain the gift of eternal life through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Would you please join in everything which is in dark print? On this great feast day, we, sisters and brothers, in communion with each other, stand together to recommit ourselves once again to fidelity in following Christ more closely through our vocation to the consecrated life. Mindful of Jesus' own words,
"You did not choose me, I chose you,"
we ask for renewed awareness of what it means to center our lives on Christ and the gospel, on the will of God, and to journey into the future continuously on a pilgrimage of transformation. We are mindful also of the challenges presented to us by St. Catherine of Siena, who said,
"Be who God meant you to be, and you will set the world on fire."
By St. Ignatius, who said,
"Go forth and set the world on fire."
And Pope Francis, who said,
"Religious should."
And so we say together, as we recommit ourselves to the Lord, we ask for strength and courage to be missionary disciples and to engage in that ongoing discernment to which Pope Francis calls us in his words,
"Look into your own inner depths and let us ask ourselves, do we have hearts that have been lulled to sleep by material things? Have our hearts preserved the restlessness of seeking you above all things, or have we let them be suffocated by things that end up hardening them?"
Lord, we look back to the past with gratitude. Gratitude for all that religious have done to spread your word and to make you known and loved. We ask you to help us to
disciples of communion as we listen attentively to the Spirit calling us to implement even more fully the essential aspects of our consecrated life.
And especially to be constantly open to the challenges of the gospel wherever we are missioned. Lord, help us to examine our fidelity to the mission entrusted to us and to have the courage and confidence to respond to new wherever possible. Help us to have a corporate presence of witness to your word and to your life. Lord, let us not allow ourselves to be robbed of missionary enthusiasm. Let us not be robbed of the joy of sharing the good news. Let us not allow ourselves to be robbed of hope. Let us refuse to be prophets of doom, for we know that your love is steadfast and that your Holy Spirit radiates light in the midst of darkness. Let us not allow ourselves to be stripped of community, to accept the challenges of loving each other. Help us not to be closed in by the comfort of our privacy or our other inner circle. Help us to avoid the corruption of worldliness. Lord, send us forth to others in community, in service, in reconciliation, and in tenderness. We trust to your unconditional love. Help us to sustain our hope-filled commitment to you and your people, now and forever.
Archbishop John, it is my honour to offer you, on behalf of all consecrated persons in the Archdiocese, Our sincere thanks for the Mass you have celebrated with us and for us on this World Feast Day for Consecrated Life. It has been a most prayerful and uplifting experience, which will help sustain us as we continue our journey through this year of the Lord, 2023. We would like to thank your priest secretary, Father Phil, for his assistance in helping us prepare our liturgy today with his great attention to detail. We would like to express our gratitude to Father Michael Branch, the Dean of the Cathedral, for his cordial welcome to the Mother Church of the Archdiocese for this special occasion. Our Mass has been enhanced by the cathedral organist and the cantor. Thank you, gentlemen. To Sister Anne Marie, the head teacher of Notre Dame School, and a member of her staff, Peter, who produced the Order of Service booklet, and we are so grateful to her for that. And to Joe Driver, our communications officer, who is responsible for this liturgy being transmitted to all who are watching by the many different forms of media communications. We salute all our religious communities and consecrated persons who have joined us by these means. Thank you for being with us. I would like to thank Tricia Gilbride for all her help and guidance, and to thank you all who have been able to travel here today. It's so good to see you. If I have missed anybody out, please forgive me. We will pray for you twice. Now, I usually forget this bit, so I'm going to say it before my last piece. Refreshments will be served in the upper Amigo Hall directly after Mass. So go out to the cathedral, turn left, and there is a lift to go upstairs. All that's left to say on behalf of Abbot Hugh, Father Jim, Sister Sheila, Sister Yvonne, and myself is thank you all and God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and may I echo all of those thanks and add to them my own thanks to you and to the vicariate team. Some of you will know that I worked as a prison chaplain for about 8 years. While I was in Leeds, I was doing two jobs, part of it was a prison chaplain. And one Christmas day, I was in the prison for Mass, and I was just the kind of assistant, and the actual named chaplain was a wonderful religious sister, Sister Kathleen O'Brien. And she worked with Sister Mary Bernard Potter, and the three of us made a kind of trinity of sorts. And Sister Kathleen, on that particular day, had to go and visit someone in healthcare. So she locked me in the vestibule between the chapel and the main wing. And she said, I'll come back for you. And she left me with one of the prison orderlies who'd helped clear up after Mass. So I was chatting to him, and I said, it must be terrible being in prison in Christmas. He said, oh, it's awful. He said, it's even worse because the person that I share a cell with is going home next week. And all he talks about is getting out and seeing his family and having his Christmas dinner and going to the pub. I said, oh gosh, I bet you could kill him. He said, Father, that's what got me in here. Now, I could have kissed Sister Kathleen when she came back and let me out. But that sense of joy at seeing you, I have that same sense, not quite of freedom in the same way. But it is such a joy to see you. In all your variety and diversity, we make up a wonderful kaleidoscope of religious in the diocese, women and men, our different charisms. So thank you to all of you for coming today. To those of you who are watching us online, a very special word of gratitude and welcome and greeting. To the religious priests and brothers and sisters, to all those who've made our celebration, as you so lovely articulated, so prayerful, an enormous thank you. Some of you may not know that we have a new Vicar General in the diocese, which is Monsignor Jerry. So it's very lovely to be able to, I think this is it your first time here as Vicar General in this celebration? So thank you very much for being here today. And of course, you know Abbot Hugh, who is the Vicar for Religious. And of course, everyone knows and loves Father Jim. So let me say a word, first of all, to Abbot Hugh, and just to say, Hugh, an enormous thank you for coming to the diocese and not really knowing anything about it or anything about you, taking on this lovely responsibility and doing it with such grace and such beautiful pastoral care. And I know you've already been on your travels and visited many communities, and it's very close to your heart to support the religious in the diocese. So Hugh, thank you for this ministry, as well as your responsibilities for your own community and for the Falkland Islands and other parts of the South Atlantic. But thank you very much, and I hope you feel welcome. I know the team delight in working with you, and so do I. So thank you very, very much, and you're most welcome. But the last word I want to say to you, Father Jim, because, gosh, if we could calculate the love in this room for you, you'd be a multi-billionaire. And we know that you have served the diocese faithfully, and most recently as the Vicar for Religious, where you have won the hearts of our religious in ways that, well, no one could imagine. And I know there are things that you've helped and eased and resolved and sorted, and so many people are grateful to you, present and past. We first met at the consecration of a consecrated virgin, and it was a memorable occasion. And since then, I think we've been firm friends. I like to think so. And so I want to thank you for your service to the diocese as Vicar for Religious, but more than that, for being such a beautiful friend of the Lord Jesus that it flows through your priesthood into our lives. We know that there is an uncertainty about how long the future is for you. But for as long as the Lord wills, we delight and rejoice in your presence. And we assure you today of our love and of our prayers as together we walk towards whatever is his gift for you at whatever time. I think we'd like to give you a little round of applause, if that's all right. Please stand for the blessing. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life. Thanks be to God.